Welcome to Irvington Presbyterian Church Virtual Worship. Allow me to greet all the fathers and those who took the role of fathers. A happy Father's Day. May the Lord bless you and make you a blessing to your family. Some of you are worshiping with us locally, others from other cities, and others from other countries. Welcome again to Irvington Presbyterian Church online worship. We're still unable to worship in our sanctuary, but the church, again, is not the building. The church are the people. You and I, we are the church. And everywhere we go, we represent Christ. And anywhere you are right now, whether at home or in other places, in your respective places, that place is sacred because you have set it aside for the worship of God. Let me read to you from Jude 1 and 2. To those who are called, who are beloved in God the Father, and kept safe in Jesus Christ, may mercy, peace, and love be yours in abundance. Let us bless the Lord together. Let us sing, Blessed be the Lord God Almighty.
Father in heaven, how we love you. We lift your name in all the earth. May your kingdom be established in our praises, as your people declare your mighty works. Blessed be the Lord God Almighty, who was and is to come. Blessed be the Lord God Almighty, who reigns forevermore. Father in heaven, how we love you. We lift your name in all the earth. May your kingdom be established in our praises, as your people declare your mighty works. Blessed be the Lord God Almighty, who was and is to come. Blessed be the Lord God Almighty, who reigns forevermore. Blessed be the Lord God Almighty, who was and is to come. Blessed be the Lord God Almighty, who reigns forevermore.
Psalm 103, verses 13 to 18 says, As a father has compassion on his children, so the Lord has compassion on those who fear him. For he knows how we are formed. He remembers that we are dust. Life of mortals is like grass. They flourish like a flower of the field. The wind blows over it, and it is gone. And its place remembers it no more. But from everlasting to everlasting, the Lord's love is with those who fear him, and his righteousness with their children's children, with those who keep his covenant and remember to obey his precepts. Our Reformed worship includes the confession. And what is the confession? It is an invitation for us to come just as we are before God, relying on His faithfulness and His mercy. As we honestly agree with God our faults and our sins and our failures, we experience His mercy. The psalmist testifies, "Happy are those whose transgression is forgiven, whose sin is covered. Happy are those to whom the Lord imputes no iniquity, and in whose spirit there is no deceit. While I kept my silence, my body wasted away through my groaning all day long. For day and night your hand was heavy upon me. My strength was dried up as by the heat of summer. Then I acknowledged my sin to you, and I did not hide my iniquity. I said, I will confess my transgression to the Lord, and you forgave the guilt of my sin. Therefore, let all who are faithful offer prayer to you." Let us spend a moment of our time in silent prayer for ourselves as we confess before God. Let us pray together this prayer of confession. Merciful God, we confess that we have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, and by what we have done and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart and mind and strength. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. In your mercy, forgive what we have been. Help us amend what we are and direct what we shall be, so that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways to the glory of your holy name. Through Christ our Lord. Amen. Hear the good news. Who is in a position to condemn? Only Christ. And Christ died for us, Christ rose for us, Christ reigns in power for us, Christ prays for us. Anyone who is in Christ is a new creation. The old life is gone. A new life has come. Know that you are forgiven and be at peace. And all God's people say, thanks be to God. Let us also respond to God's mercy and forgiveness by singing the Gloria Patri, also known as Glory to the Father.
Glory be to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Ghost. As it was in the beginning, is now, and ever shall be, world without end. Amen. Amen.
Let us now sing hymn number 143, This is My Father's World.
This is my Father's world, and to my listening ears, all nature sings and round me rings the music of the spheres. This is my Father's world. I rest me in the thought of rocks and trees, of skies and seas, His hand a wonders wrought. This is my Father's world. The birds their carols raise, the morning light, the lily white, declare their Maker's praise. This is my Father's world. He shines in all that's fair. In the rustling grass I hear Him pass. He speaks to me everywhere. This is my Father's world. Oh, let me ne'er forget that though the wrong sins are so strong, God is the ruler yet. This is my Father's world. He shines in all that's fair. Jesus who died shall be satisfied, and earth and be one.
Let us pray. You are the sovereign one, O God, and rightly to be blessed. Your name shall ever be upon our lips. You have heard the poor and saved them from trouble. You have enlightened believers. Their faces reflect your radiance, aglow with the splendor of your promised redemption. We gather in our respective places to worship you. You are the ruler of nations. Father God, we celebrate Father's Day today. Behold, our families are assembled virtually here. We thank you for all the fathers that are here. We also thank you for the place in which we dwell, for the love that unites us, for the peace given us this day, for the hope with which we expect the future, for the health, the work, the food, and the bright skies that make our lives delightful. For our friends in all parts of the earth, give us courage and joy and a quiet mind. Spare to us our friends, soften to us our enemies. Bless us, if it may be, in all our innocent endeavors. If it may not, give us the strength to endure that which is to come, that we may be brave in peril, constant in tribulation, temperate in wrath and in all changes of future, and down to the gates of death. Loyal and loving to one another, as the clay to the potter, as the windmill to the wind, as children to their parents, we beseech you this help and mercy for Christ's sake. Father God, we do not live by bread alone, but by every word that comes from your mouth. Make us hungry for your word, that it may nourish us today and in the ways of eternal life. Through Jesus Christ, the bread of heaven, we pray. Amen. The scripture for today is found in Matthew chapter 10, verses 24 to 29.
Good morning. Today's scripture readings is book of Matthew, chapter 10, verse 24 to 29. The student is not above the teacher, nor a servant above his master. It is enough for students to be like their teachers, and servants like their master. If the head of the house has been called Beelzebul, how much more the members of his household? So do not be afraid of them, for there is nothing concealed that will not be disclosed, or hidden that will not be made known. What I tell you in the dark, speak in the daylight. When it whispered in your ear, proclaims from the roof. Do not be afraid of those who kill the body, but cannot kill the soul. Rather, be afraid of the one who can kill, who can destroy both soul and body in hell. And are not two sparrows sold for a penny? Yet not one of them will fall to the ground outside your Father's care. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
God has gifted us with fathers, and fatherhood is patterned after God, because God is our Heavenly Father. As we have biological fathers who cares for His family, God is the model of fatherhood as He cares for His creation. Let's take a look at what the biblical view of father is. The word Ab in Hebrew is actually a very difficult word because no one knows its origin. However, in the Greek, pater, which we have the word father, pater actually comes from the root word pa, which we sometimes call our dad pa. And the Greek word pater actually means a lot of things. It means someone who nourishes, someone who protects, someone who upholds his family, upholds his value, the values of the society, upholds that which is right. That is a father. Now, in the Old Testament, there are many, many descriptions of fathers. It gives us the duties and the character of a father. In Genesis 37, it tells us that the father loves his children. And in chapter 50, where Jacob was about to die and he was blessing his children, he gave commands. And fathers instructs in Proverbs. In Jeremiah, a father guides, encourages, and warns his people, warns his family. In Hosea, a father trains his children. And the Bible also tells us the father rebukes, restrains, punishes, chastens, nourishes, delights in his son, in his children, give wisdom to his children, is considerate to his children, and is not a burden to his children, does not provoke his children to wrath or anger. All these things wrap up in what a father is. And a father is pitiful, is merciful, is kind, compassionate to his children. We just read this in our call to worship. As a father has compassion to his children, so the Lord has compassion upon his people. An article is written by Anna Macken, and it's entitled "The Marvel of the Human Dad." She says it very succinctly. Let me read it for you. She said, "Dads are designed by God to be different from mothers. For starters, fathers are designed to relate to their children through highly physical play, with lots of throwing up in the air, jumping about and tickling, accomplished by loud shouts and laughter." Of course, fathers also cuddle. But this fatherly play has two benefits, she says. First, its exuberant nature allows dads to build a bond with his children. And quickly using hits on their neurochemicals that builds this strong bond. Secondly, due to the riskiness of the play, it begins to teach the child about the give and take of relationship. Even from a very young age, fathers are teaching their children crucial life lessons. Why do kids need this dad rough and tumble play and not just a good cuddle? Well, she says, because analysis has shown that fathers and children get their peaks of these neurochemicals indicating increased rewards from playing together. And corresponding peaks for mothers and babies is that when they are being affectionate. In contrast, a father's attachment to his child has elements of affection and care as well, but it is based on challenge. A father turns his children's face outward, encouraging to build relationships, succeed in the world, and developing a child's sense of worth. And so Mackin concludes by saying that we need to change our cultural conversation about fathers. Some fathers are absent and inept, but the majority of fathers are not these people. We need to discuss the dads who stick around for their children, who coach football, read bedtime stories, locate missing school socks, and scare away the nighttime monsters. We need fathers who encourage their children's mental resilience and train them to enter our increasingly complex social world. Fathers are important. Now, we know that there are different traits of fathers, and fathers teach their children to appreciate things, to open their minds, to accept that his children aren't like him, to spend quality time with their children, to lead by example, and to be supportive and loyal, and challenge their kids to greater heights. Even though life can be hard, even though the task can be overwhelming, to challenge them to overcome these obstacles. Fathers teach their kids lessons, life lessons. Sometimes when the kids do something that's wrong, the father comes alongside to teach them, instruct them, protects his family no matter what, show unconditional love to their children and family. And most of all, a father shows his children how to love their mothers. See, Jesus also teaches his disciples what it means to have the Father's care. Jesus said, you know what? Birds, the sparrows of the air, they're worth so little, and yet your Heavenly Father cares for them. And you are more valuable to God than these sparrows. How does our Heavenly Father care for us? Well, for starters, our Heavenly Father doesn't just care for Christians. He cares for all His creation. In Matthew 5, 43 and 45, it says, "You have heard that it was said, love your neighbor and hate your enemy. But I tell you, love your enemies and pray for those who persecute you, that you may be children of your Father in heaven." Why? He causes His Son to rise on the evil and the good, and sends rain on the righteous and the unrighteous. God does not discriminate from His creation. His love and His care, His general care, extends to all. We all benefit from what God, our Heavenly Father, has for us. But other than this, our Heavenly Father specially cares for the followers of His Son, Jesus Christ. How does God show His special care upon those who follow Jesus Christ? God challenges us like a father. He says, this life has suffering because Jesus said, they call me Beelzebub, they call me the evil one, and they would persecute you as well. So this is the challenge, that in your persecution, God still cares for you. When life is tough, God still cares for you. It doesn't matter what happens outside, but you know that what's inside is where God's strength is, God's spirit is, God's encouragement is. And in Acts chapter 5 and verse 41, it tells us that the apostles, after Jesus ascended to heaven, went out and preached the gospel, and they were arrested by the Jews, brought to their courts called the Sanhedrin, and they were flogged. They were asked not to preach the gospel again. And what did the apostles do? The apostles left the Sanhedrin, the Bible says, rejoicing because they had been counted worthy of suffering disgrace for the name, with a capital N, the name of Jesus Christ. See, suffering does not deter us from loving God. Suffering and persecution does not deter us from helping others, to showing God's love to others. It is a challenge to us. And in Philippians chapter 3 and verse 10, the Apostle Paul says, I want to know Christ, yes, to know the power of His resurrection, the participation in His suffering, becoming like Him in His death. See, the Apostle Paul says, it doesn't matter, I'm in prison, because when he was writing the Philippian letters, the letter to the Philippians, he was in prison in Rome. And he says, you know what? I count it as a badge of honor to suffer for Jesus Christ and to love others and to share the gospel to others. God uses suffering and persecution to stretch our faith, like a father who challenges us to face what is outside. The world is complex. The world is hard. The world, you have to face the challenges of the world. But God says, I'm with you. I'll give you the strength. I'll give you the words. I'll give you whatever you need to rise above the challenges that you meet today. Our Heavenly Father is the model of fatherhood to us all who are fathers. Jesus said in verse 26 and 27 that everything would be disclosed. All that is said in secret will be exposed. That's a very scary thing. But Jesus is telling us that, you know what? If you are doing something right, and if your heart is clean and your heart is pure, you're not afraid to be exposed, because there's nothing to be exposed. See, God the Father models for us what fatherhood is. We help our children to know what is right and what is wrong. We have nothing to hide. False witnesses lied about Jesus during His trial, and that's why Jesus was nailed to the cross. But the Father did not left Him there. And God would judge people's secret in Romans 2:16. It says, this will take place on the day when God judges people's secret through Jesus Christ, as the Bible declares. God sees the heart, and he tells us what is right and wrong. And when we fear God and we have the reverence of God in our hearts, then we will follow and we will obey. Matthew 10:28 says, "Do not be afraid of those who kill the body, but cannot kill the soul. Rather, be afraid of the one who can destroy both soul and body in hell." And who is that? And that is God. We are to fear God and God alone. Our society today tells us that we should not be fearful of anything. And that is not right, because the Bible tells us that there are authorities above us that we should give respect and fear and reverence. And God is the ultimate, the absolute. In Psalm 111 and verse 10, it says, "The fear of the Lord is the beginning of wisdom. A good understanding have all they that do his commandments." See, when you fear the Lord, when you revere the Lord, you will obey the Lord. In Asia, fathers have a lot of authority. You cannot call your dad by his full name. What your dad says, that's the law of the family. Of course, nowadays, the younger ones are rebelling, but pretty much when I was growing up, that was the case. One time I called my dad by his name, and sure enough, I got something from him. Reverence to God is very important. It gives us this fear, but yet it also gives us a consolation, knowing that we belong to Him. We belong to God. And that there is no condemnation when we belong to God. In John chapter 5 and verse 24, it says, Jesus says, "Very truly I tell you, whoever hears my word and believes in him who sent me has eternal life and will not be judged, but has crossed over from death to life." See, when God is our Father and we fear him, we revere him, then God takes us as his own. And in Romans 8 and verse 1, it says, There is now no condemnation for those who are in Christ. And Martin Luther, the great reformer, in his song called "The Mighty Fortress Is Our God," he says, "Let goods and kindred go, this mortal life also, the body they can kill, God's truth abideth still. His kingdom is forever." God's kingdom is forever. See, the fear of God is the fear that cancels all other fears. When you fear God, you are not afraid of the challenges of this world, because you know that you belong to God, and God, and you have faith in God, and that God takes care of his own. Jesus said in verse 29, he says, "Are not two sparrows sold for a penny? Not one of them will fall to the ground outside your Father's care." A sparrow, again, is worth just a fraction of a dollar, not as valuable as we are. God values us more than the sparrow. And if God values us more than the sparrow, and God takes care of the sparrow, how much more for us? God cares for us. God takes care of us. The one that we did not read is about hair. Hair loss. Know that this could be a sensitive topic. But Jesus says, "The very hairs of your head are numbered." I don't count my hairs, because I could hardly count my hairs. But they are numbered before God. The question is, do you know which of your hair is the oldest hair in your head? Can you point out that this hair is the youngest hair in your head? Which one falls off today and maybe... Well, horrible things can happen if more hairs fall today. But which ones have come off with your brush this morning? Now, I don't know, and I don't think you would know, but God knows. Because He did not just count them, He numbered them. So, if God cares for us like a father, if God models for us fatherhood, and He is the perfect Father, shouldn't we acknowledge Him as our Heavenly Father? And if you don't know Him yet, just says, I am the way to the Father. He is the way, the truth, and the life. He is the one who brings us to the Father. Believe in Christ. Trust Him. Acknowledge God as your Heavenly Father, because He cares for His creation, and He cares for you. Amen. Amen. In response to our Heavenly Father's love and care, let us sing hymn number 576, The Steadfast Love of the Lord.
The steadfast love of the Lord never ceases. His mercies never come to an end. They are new every morning, new every morning. Great is Thy faithfulness, O Lord. Great is Thy faithfulness. The steadfast love of the Lord never ceases. His mercies never come to an end. They are new every morning, new every morning. Great is Thy faithfulness, O Lord. Great is Thy faithfulness.
Let us sing the doxology together. Let us pray. Almighty Father, You have done great things for us, and holy is Your name. Bless all we offer to You, ourselves, our time, and our possessions, that through us Your grace and favor may be made known to all the world, for the sake of Jesus Christ, our Redeemer. Amen. God calls us to be a people of prayer, a community of people who lift up our voices before His throne of grace. So let us bring our thanksgiving and concerns before God's throne of grace. Let us pray. Let us pray silently before God. Lord, hear our prayer. We pray to you, O Lord, hear our voice. We wait for your answer. Accept all these prayers offered in Jesus' name, and give us now the strength to wait patiently for your answer and to live faithfully in response to your call, through Christ our Lord. Let us continue to pray as our Lord taught us to pray. Our Father who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. A tribute to all the fathers.
Shepherd and sheep, my God and I, to fresh green fields you led my steps in days gone by.
You gave me grace by quiet springs, and filled my soul.
Oh, shelter me, the way of earth is dark and difficult to see. Oh, shelter me, all will be well if only shelter me. Oh, shelter me, the way ahead is dark and difficult to see. Oh, shelter me, oh, shelter me, all will be well if only shelter me.
Trusting that in your mercy you have
shelter me. Oh, shelter me. The way ahead is dark and difficult to see. Oh, shelter me. Oh, shelter me. All will be well if only you will shelter me.
Happy Father's Day. Thank you for doing so much and everything and being there. Happy Father's Day.
Hey, Irvington Presbyterian Church. I've got a special message for my dad, Bob Fry. I don't know about you guys, but I've been spending a lot of time indoors recently. That's led me to reminisce about all our great yearly backpacking trips. From the John Muir Trail to the High Sierra Trail and to the top of Mount Rainier. They all were amazing. Thanks for spending all the quality time with me, Dad, and for showing me the great outdoors. I hope you and all the other fathers out there have a happy Father's Day.
Hi, Dad. Happy Father's Day. Hope you're having a great one. Thank you for always being there for me and always being kind and caring.
Hi, Dad. Happy Father's Day. Thank you so much for your love and support that you've provided me throughout my endeavors and plans. I have only you to thank for where I am today and for the trust you put into me making autonomous decisions as a minor. I'm sorry I can't physically be with you this Father's Day, but I am with you in spirit. I'm excited to finish the academy, to watch my dream come to fruition, a journey that started with a newspaper ad in the subway many years ago. Thanks, Dad. Lots of love, Eric.
Hi, Paul. Happy Father's Day. You're a wonderful father to our three children. You're loving, caring, supportive, and you're always there for them. You work so hard to support a family, and we love you very much. Lots of love to you, and have a wonderful Father's Day. May.
Hey, Dad, happy Father's Day. I bet this is quite the surprise for you. I just wanted to say that I love you and I think about you a lot, and I hope you're having a good day. I know we're talked today, but I just wanted to send this special message to you and tell you that you're the best father ever, and you're the only one, but really your wisdom and guidance has really helped throughout the years, and I just wanted to say thank you and that I love you, and happy Father's Day. Hi, everybody at church.
Hi, my name's Tracy. I've been nominated by my siblings, since I am my father's favorite child, to speak on their behalf. My father's name is Charles Scafidi, aka the Sarge. He's a retired Marine who has showed us love throughout our whole life. He's been there for us, provided for us. He's a wonderful man. And we'd like to honor him on this Father's Day by saying, we love you, Pop. Have a happy Father's Day.
Hi, I'm Christy Thompson. I am Richard Craig's youngest daughter. Just wanted to say how much we love and appreciate all you've done for our family, Dad. We love you so much. Happy Father's Day.
Happy Father's Day, Dad. When I thought of making this video, I wanted to take the camera around the garage and show all the tools that you taught me to use over the years, such as this voltmeter here. But you've taught me so much more than tools. One of the biggest lessons is to be available for others. And I've seen this throughout your life. Thank you for that great lesson. Happy Father's Day.
Dear Dad, Happy Father's Day. You are awesome, the best dad in the world, and funny. Happy Father's Day.
Dad, thank you for teaching me new skills and always being a funny guy. Thank you. Happy Father's Day.
Happy Father's Day, Papa. We love you. I love you.
Thank you, Dad, for all these years of taking care of me. Thank you for teaching me right from wrong and making me smile. Thank you for all the precious memories that you've given me. Thank you for helping me with everything that I've done. And thank you for teaching me everything that I've known. My wish for you this Father's Day and many years to come is for you to stop working so hard and come home early so we can spend more time together. And as always, thank you for being my father. Happy Father's Day.
Happy Father's Day, Dad. Thank you for being the best dad I can ever wish for. And thank you for being funny and supportive all my life. Have a great day.
Happy Father's Day, Dad. Thank you for teaching me the value of hard work and raising me to be a good Christian.
Hi, Dad. Happy Father's Day. We love and miss you very much.
And we want to say thank you for everything that you've done for our family and for all the family that you have there at the church.
And I know things are really tough right now. We'd like nothing more than to see you and spend the day with you. But I promise, as soon as this whole COVID thing is over, we'll all be together again and we'll get to spoil you like you richly deserve. We love you very much, Dad.
Love you.
See you soon.
G is for great.
R is for really good at cooking steak.
Can you say A is for awesome?
Grammy.
A is for Grammy and awesome.
Yay! Woo! M is for makes me happy. And Grammy.
Hey, Grammy. Bella.
P is for
please.
Please help. Very helpful.
A is for A plus Dad and Grandpa. Happy Father's Day.
Happy Father's Day, Grandpa.
I love you so much. Say Happy Father's Day, Grandpa.
Say we love you.
Keep blow kissy.
Love you, kissy. Love you, Grandpa.
We love you.
Makes me happy.
Happy Father's Day, Mustafa.
Happy Father's Day. Thanks, Daddy, for teaching me the importance of serving others. I use it every day as a critical care nurse. Love you.
Happy Father's Day, Daddy. Thanks for teaching me the value of education. That's why I'm here at UCSF, studying to be a nurse practitioner. Happy Father's Day!
Hey, Daddy. Growing up, you were an excellent teacher. Until today, you continue to inspire me to become a better person. I hope to inspire my students as much as you inspire me. I love you, Daddy. Happy Father's Day!
Just started recording, so on the count of three, we will say start it off. One, two, three. Happy Father's Day, Dad.
Always so grateful for you to help with the our academics while we were in school and with all the extracurriculars.
Dad, I have three dogs now, and I'm surprised how you survived to raise us. I was a terrible teenager, and now that I have three dogs, I realize how awful kids are.
I appreciate how much time you spent at all my activities for cross country, Boy Scouts, sports, everything. Really appreciate it. I love you, Dad.
We love you, Dad.
Love you.
Some of us have been Christians for many generations. Faith of Our Fathers celebrates this precious faith. However, some of us here are first-generation Christians. You can also celebrate the faith of our spiritual fathers. Abraham is called the father of faith. And all the Christians, all those who have worshiped God in the past, are our spiritual fathers. And we celebrate their faith as well. Let us sing hymn number 404, Faith of Our Fathers, Living Still.
Faith of our fathers living still, in spite of dungeon, fire, and sword. Oh, how our hearts beat high with joy whenever we hear that glorious word. Faith of our fathers, holy faith, we will be true to thee till death. Faith of our fathers, we will strive to win all nations unto thee. And through the faith that comes from God, mankind shall then be truly free. Faith of our fathers, holy faith, we will be true to thee till death. Faith of our fathers, we will love both friends and foe in all our strife, and preach thee to all love knows how, by kindly words and virtuous life. Faith of our fathers, holy faith, we will be true to thee till death.
Let us pray. Go forth in the name of the Lord. This is God's charge. We should believe in the name of His Son, Jesus Christ, and love one another, just as He commanded us. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make His face to shine upon you and be gracious to you. The Lord turn His face toward you and give you peace. And all God's people say, Alleluia, Amen.
Good morning, IPC, and thank you for worshiping with us this morning. Status of the campus, campus is still closed except for the breakfast on Monday, Wednesday, and Friday. We are still requesting that you provide comments on the returning to the sanctuary worship draft plan. We have scheduled a Zoom meeting for Sunday, July 12th, immediately following worship, so that we may listen to you and share some of the plans and how we're thinking about returning to the sanctuary for worship. IPC responds to the current movement in rooting out injustice. One of the things we've been looking at is, what does love your neighbor really mean? And what will you do differently? With so many of the COVID-19 restrictions being lifted around the country, it's a good thing. However, for the past week, we've noticed that in 14 states, including California, the number of infections continue to increase. That's not good. So we pray that you will wear a mask as much as you can and continue to practice social distancing, so that you're showing that you do love your neighbor. It is the loving thing to do by wearing your mask and practicing social distancing during this pandemic. As we begin the fifth week of protests against injustice, this outcry is not slowing down. I don't know how you feel about it, But I see three things that are happening right now. One is the diversity of the protesters. You see young people, you see old people, grandmas, grandpas, you know, white, black, brown, everybody joining our black brothers and sisters to protest against racial injustice across the globe. And as I said, as across the globe, the movement is worldwide. It happens, is happening in Europe, it's happening in Australia, in Hong Kong, in Japan. Everywhere you go, young people are protesting injustice. And I think it's a good thing. This generation is saying once and for all, we need to root out this injustice. As a church, we can no longer stay silent. Staying silent is complicit. We need to stand with our young generation and work to root out bigotry, hate, and prejudice. As you know, I've been talking about reading the book of James. And James chapter 2, verse 1 states, "My brothers and sisters, believers in our glorious Lord Jesus Christ, must not show favoritism." Powerful verse. You know, loving your neighbor means never treating people in different ways according to their outward appearance. Sometimes you see somebody whose skin color is different. You don't have to. You have to accept that person for who he is or who she is. If you see somebody on the side of the street sleeping, it doesn't mean the person is homeless. You got to be able to show love. You got to be able to understand what's happening. And I think loving your neighbor, as we've talked about, means never treating people in different ways according to their outward appearance. Treat others as you would like to be treated. I think that's what God put us here for, to love one another. Interesting that this past Monday at the session meeting, you know, Pastor was reading from Genesis and he was talking about loving one another. And he said God made everybody in his image. And you know what? If that's true, even the people of color is made in God's image. So we've got to love everybody. Some additional announcements. Farmington, well, the boxes are ready. We're planting, so if you feel safe, join other Farmingtonians on Saturday mornings. This past week, we saw an increase in the number of guests served in the breakfast program. We served about 90 plus boxes. I think one day it was, might have been Wednesday, we served 100 breakfasts. So things are happening there. I just want to share with you, Kathy McDonald is off for 3 weeks, and when she returns, she will need to go through a self-quarantine period for 2 weeks. So that means she's out of the breakfast program for 5 weeks. We can certainly need some help. So if you feel the need, and if you feel safe, and you would like to help, please contact Jean Garrett. Clean Start is back after repairs and is running flat out. In serving our church community, remember, if you're unable to shop or need groceries or aware of someone who needs groceries, contact Outreach Ministries at 510-579-3694 and we will bring to you eggs, milk, butter, cheese, cereal, some other staples on Saturday morning. Fathers, we hope you enjoyed your strawberry shortcake packages that were left on your porch or front door yesterday. And we invite you to watch the Tribute to Fathers presentation right after these announcements. It's going to be great. I haven't seen so much enthusiasm and interest among kids and mothers to get this going. Fathers, you are so well loved. I think you're going to enjoy this presentation. The weekly drive-through food pantry that we mentioned last week will begin on July 11th. So watch E! News and Cornerstone for additional information. We're planning for you, IPC, a very special 4th of July. We can't get together and hug one another, be very close to each other. But this year, we are sponsoring a drive-through picnic. So what does that mean? It means you will be asked to let us know how many people in your party will be coming. We will be cooking for you, hot dogs, hamburgers, and we'll have water. I don't know what else we have planned, but that's what we have so far. You will be asked to stay in your vehicle, order what you need, somebody will bring it to you, and you drive off. Now, you can either drive off if you want someone, if you want communion, there will be pastors to provide communion. If you want prayer, there'll be pastors to provide prayer. But you will stay in your car, and you can move to different areas in the parking lot. One thing we're also doing is we will be painting circles on the lawn between Chapel Road, the sanctuary, and the social hall. We will paint 12-foot circles that, you know, the same family can go into the circle and stay there. The circles will be well spaced, so if you have a bubble, it'd be okay. You can come there and have your lunch. Watch for more information on the 4th of July in E! News, and I think we will be asking people to sign up so we know how many people are coming to the picnic. We have a lot of things planned. We love you. We miss you. And as you can see, we're in the sanctuary is really lonely without you guys. We love you. Take care. God bless you.